Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So in last class, we discussed about toxins in the end. And why I discussed toxins, because you need to understand that there are two types of toxins. I hope you all go back and revise the notes before you come in the next, because whatever I teach in the last class actually somewhere connects. The way I end the class connects to the class. So today we'll be studying about, when we'll be starting the new kingdom, we'll be studying about toxins in a little bit of detail, okay? So let's begin with next category that we are going to start today, that is euglenoids. How many of you have heard the word euglena?
I guess it's new word.
Is it a new word?
Yes, sir. For me, it's new.
Okay. So, euglenoids, the word basically comes from euglena. Euglena organism, and a very important organism from, you know, biologist's point of view. And why it's important, we'll study about this. But euglenoids, basically it's named after, not after this, this organism belong to a group. There are a lot of organisms in this group, but they are very diverse. But what we are in, and why are we studying euglenoids, is because majority of them are freshwater organisms. So they are basically present around us. You know, they are present in all sorts of freshwater sources, like ponds, rivers, and these are the sources where we get potable water, right? So we drink fresh water, right? We cannot drink marine water or water from the oceans and the seas, right? And they also live in the freshwater sources. Euglena are actually very important for understanding the ecology of the water, you know, because euglena can be found in stagnant water. You understand what do we mean by stagnant water?
Yes, sir.
What is stagnant water?
Still water.
Still water.
Not just still. Stagnant is still, like it's not moving, but when water does not move, you know why rivers are considered the best source of drinking water and not lakes and ponds?
Because they are moving.
So river is constantly moving, and when it's moving, it's not allowing any kind of a growth to just overwhelm the river ecology, right? And when it is it's moving, shows that it must be having a source, right? Water only moves if it is constantly it's coming from somewhere. Because river keeps flowing throughout the year, but still there is water in the river. So where the water is coming from and where it is going?
It's coming from...
This is 101 geography.
Himalaya.
From mountains?
Yeah, it's coming from mountains. Himalaya is one of the mountain ranges. All the rivers in the world are not coming from Himalaya. And even all the rivers in India are not coming from Himalaya, but often they come from a high source, a source which is high. Most of the times these are mountains. And where does water come on mountains? Who has installed a tap there, which is open and the river is flowing always? Where is the water coming from? So this is the water cycle that you must have studied. And euglena is important for that. So where is the water coming?
Rain.
Yes, Maria. Sorry, rain.
Rain.
So rains are happening everywhere, right? It's raining also in Delhi, but or other lowland areas. But rivers follow a path.
Sometimes it's like
from ocean, the evaporation.
Sorry, one at a time. Yes, Aisha.
Sometimes like when the water, like in cold regions and all, when they are formed ice and right. They will break into the ground.
Yes, so you touched upon an important point, ice. So it's not about cold areas, it's about height. So these mountains are very high, very, very high. You know, Himalayans are the highest mountain ranges because it's also the youngest. So over time, these mountains, so first they grow in size because they are the youngest, things deposit. And then under their own weight and under wear and tear and weathering, they starts becoming smaller. But this happens in millions of years. So all the mountain ranges are smaller than Himalayas, like in height, because they are older than Himalayas. Himalaya is the youngest mountain range that is produced. And because they are so high, at very high heights, what happens is it's very cool. and all the water which is present as water vapor in the air condenses and forms ice sheets on these mountains. So you will see tall mountains always covered with snow. So they have a snowy peak, right? Am I right? Whereas hills may not have a snowy peak. Hills are smaller, mountains are taller. So all that water which is there in the atmosphere, when it rises up, settles down on these mountains in the form of snow. And this snow over millions of years form glaciers. And these are very big reservoirs of fresh waters. And glaciers, when they melt, they keep on melting, because as they will come down, the temperature will increase and they will melt, and that actually fills the river. So this river is also filled on the way by rains. As you are saying, when it rains heavily, sometimes rivers overflow and there is flood. Rain is one source of filling the rivers, but another source is glaciers. Now, there are also rivers which actually do not arise from mountains, because mountains are only at the northern part of India. Let's consider India for that matter. So all the northern rivers like the Ganga, Yamuna, these are originated from the Himalayan glaciers, but other rivers which are down south do not arise from mountains. So they arise still from the highlands, which is called the Deccan Plateau, but they are filled constantly by rain, as Aisha was saying. Do you understand the river ecology now?
Yes.
And it keeps on moving. And when it's flowing, it goes. And where does it go? What is the end point of every river?
Oceans,
because till there is land, it will keep flowing. So when land ends and ocean starts, it will go and merge in the ocean. So basically all our fresh water is going into oceans and mixing with the salty water. Okay. But that's why this cycle is very important in ecology. Now, Euglena is actually a marker for foul water, because it's found in stagnant water, and stagnant does not only mean just stopped, because pond water is also static, it's not moving, but all the ponds are not stagnant. They are live ponds. Stagnant is which has foul water. You know, by foul water, I mean there is a lot of organic growth or inorganic pollution in it, which is making the water not fit for drinking. So what we do is, when we take water samples from rivers or from ponds or these lakes, and we test them, if we see euglenoids growing in it beyond a number, you know, because they are found in fresh water, but if they are beyond what we can tell about the quality of water, that the water is not fit for drinking. Okay. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
So often question comes that they are a marker for checking quality of water. Euglenoids. Okay. So they are found right now. They are found in fresh water and stagnant water. They grow well in stagnant water. Now, the organisms, basically, as I told you, that whenever aquatic organisms are living, like single cell bacteria we saw, and we also saw diatoms and dinoflagellates, they have protective layer around themselves, right? Sometimes it's the cell wall. In case of dinoflagellates, also some may have cell walls. But why we don't keep, and I have also told you that diatoms and dinoflagellates also grow in water. No, but they grow in marine water. So that is one difference. Second is, they may have covering hard outer shells, which are not exactly cell wall. You remember, in the case of diatoms, it's a silica-based
material.
Similarly, in case of euglenoids, it's not a cell wall. So cell wall is a characteristic feature. If it would have been cell wall, it would have been easier for us to place it in with some or the other category. But instead of a cell wall, they have a protein coat. So write down. They have a protein-rich layer, which is called pellicle. So the word pellicle is always associated with euglenoids. So whenever you see this, remember we are talking about euglenoids. And pellicle is a protein, a very thick protein-rich layer. So to protect themselves, they do not depend on peptidoglycans or polysaccharides or cellulose or chitin or silica. They depend on protein. That layer is called pellicle. Okay. and the characteristic feature, so this is one of the characteristic feature, make a star, because many things can be found in stagnant water. Remember, it may or may not be euglena or euglenoids, but if it has a pellicle, it's euglenoid. Second, it has flagella. All of them are flagellated. They are flagellated organisms. Now, do you remember what is flagella? So let's make a euglenoid. Let's suppose this is an euglenoid, just a random shape. So they will always have a flagella arising from one end. Anyone remember what was a flagella? I told you about flagella. Flagella.
The long strings attached.
What is it? It's the long
string.
It's like a tail. Just like sperms, human sperms have tail, you know, and it helps in the movement. So this flagella can act like a rotor. You move this flagella and this movement will help in the movement of this whole organism, this whole cell. Is it clear? So
yes,
all
sir.
These,
yes,
all
sir.
These, and it is also very important that for them to have flagella, because see, it's understandable. If they are found in stagnant water, they cannot move just by the water current. Make sense? So
yes,
in
sir.
Biology, everything that has evolved must have a logic. And if you can figure out that logic, if you know that euglenoids are found in stagnant water, you can relate that, oh, so if they are found in stagnant water, the stagnant water does not have water current, it's not free flowing. So how they will, they cannot just depend on random movement. You know, something will just move them. So they have flagella, because they have to move from one part to the other, okay, for their food or other things. So they all are flagellated. And apart from being just flagellated, they actually have two flagellas. So most of them are biflagellated. You remember two flagella was a feature of something else? Who will tell me? So two flagella was a feature of something else, where one flagella was at the transverse and one was at the longitudinal plane to the body axis. Whose feature was this? Where one flagella is at the transverse to the axis and one flagella is the longitudinal to the body axis. Tell me, I've told you this. Should I go up? Remember this? Just above. Dinoflagellates. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so when no one speaks, I think my connection is gone. So in dinoflagellates, so dinoflagellates are also biflagellated. They also have two flagella. But the difference is that in dinoflagellates, one flagella is attached to the transverse axis of the body axis and another to the longitudinal axis. You understand? Whereas in euglenoids, both the flagella arise from the same point and are in the same axis. Will you remember this? So this is
yes,
one
sir.
Different feature. Okay. So if there comes a question in your NEET where they say that the characteristic feature of euglenoids is that the characteristic feature of an organism is that it is biflagellated, don't just go for euglenoids. Look for other features. Pellicle is the defining feature, because biflagellated, it's also dinoflagellates. But if they say that both the flagella are in different body axes, then they are talking about dinoflagellates. And if they say nothing about the flagella axis and they mention the word pellicle, they're talking about euglenoids. So you have to remember, you don't have to mug up everything. You just have to remember some characteristic features. So when you are making your short notes or your notes for entrances, just remember the characteristic features. Okay. And that's how biology becomes a little easier. Write down, they are photosynthetic. They are photosynthetic. So if they are photosynthetic, in which nutritional category they come in?
Autotrophic.
Yes, photosynthetic, autotrophic. Okay. So they can do photosynthesis. And if a question comes, so I have seen this question, it's not important for your boards, but let me prepare you for this question. What is the advantage of a pellicle over a cell wall? So cell wall or a silica wall, or a chitin wall, or a cellulosic wall. They all are cell walls. We already had so many cell walls. Why did an organism like euglenoid developed a different kind of cell wall altogether? Why not take any kind of cell wall which is already existing in the nature? So pellicle, being proteinaceous in nature, actually allows a lot of flexibility to flagella. Apart from protection, it also allows flexibility. You remember, in case of diatoms, they are so hard that even if the organism within dies, the diatoms stays, you know, it's indestructible. It keeps on depositing as layers and layers, and over millions of years, it forms a diatomaceous earth. Remember that?
Yes, sir.
But for pellicles, but for euglenoids, even they have a protein-rich layer instead of a cell wall. They get the protection, but they are also flexible. So write down, pellicle provides flexibility over other cell walls. Pellicle provides flexibility over other cell walls. Now, about their flagella, they are biflagellated, but one flagella will always be smaller and one will be bigger. Both will not be of the same size. Okay, this is another thing that is asked. Now, why do you think, how do you think it helps? Just think like a logical biologist now. By now, you have to start thinking like a biologist. For everything, there has to be a reason. Why do you think one flagella is smaller and one flagella is bigger? How does it help?
Does it support its body?
Sorry? Yes, Aisha?
Sometimes you are saying that it supports the body function if there is any disorder in the body. So, is it something like that?
It's like, it's more to do with movement. Sometime you need to cover more distance in a stagnant water, and for that you need the bigger flagella to work. Sometimes you just need to, you know, shift here and there. You don't have to move. Just like for us, we have to walk sometimes and run sometimes, right?
So it's for the body movement?
Yes, it's for the body movement. So basically, bigger flagellas take more energy, because they are actually, so I will be telling you about flagellas in detail if we come to that, because suppose this is the body membrane, and the way flagellas are attached, they actually have a slight tint, and then they are like this. Okay, so they are attached like this to a cell membrane, and there is a lot of motor proteins here. Now, why we call it motor proteins? Because they basically, just in a manner of physical motor moves, they rotate in a physical motor, where from one side they are using energy and on the other side the energy is coming out after utilized. Like this is the charged battery and this is a recharged battery. ATP converts into ADP because the energy is used in rotating it. And when it rotates, this rotates. You understand?
Yes, sir.
It's exactly like a physical motor. So they are using a lot of energy. So these two flagellas help them to regulate their movement, whether they want to move for longer distances or for shorter distances. Okay. And about photosynthesis, they are photosynthetic autotrophs, but the most characteristic feature of them is, now you, no one of you asked that if a water is stagnant, let me ask you, what happened in a stagnant water body? Have you seen a stagnant foul water body? We see a green kind of layer over the top.
Yes, sir.
Yes. What is that layer? What is that layer? We studied about that layer.
Algae.
It can be algae, it can be plants, but remember slime molds?
Yes, sir.
So slime molds, actually, they look like plant, but they're not plants. Okay, so we'll be studying about slime molds later on. So slime molds or plants or sometimes algae also, so they cover the upper surface. And when they cover the upper surface, do you think sunlight can penetrate down in a stagnant pond?
No, sir.
But then how are they, will they survive if they are photosynthetic?
They choose other methods.
Yes. So euglenoids have evolved very beautifully. Yes.
The stagnant water can make us sick.
Stagnant water can?
Make us sick.
Yes, it can make you sick because it's foul water. That's what I have written. It's foul water. It's not fit for drinking. because it's stagnant, it's not moving. So whatever is the growth happening inside the water, it's just multiplying. And after some time, the dissolved oxygen is over and all these plants starts dying and a foul smell starts coming out of it, right? So every lake or pond remains fresh and not stagnate because of constant rain, or there should be something constantly filling it. So rain, ponds and lakes also have their sources. Sometimes it's the groundwater, do you know? Sometimes the lakes and ponds are so deep that they get filled by the groundwater. So that is still not stagnant. It's not moving, but it's static, but not stagnant, because something is filling it constantly with new water, fresh water. Do you understand?
Yes.
Yes. Have you seen these oases in deserts? These oases, and there are lakes or ponds, like water bodies, yes, in the middle of the desert.
Yes, sir.
So you must, have you ever thought that where does water come from in the middle of the desert? Is it a miracle? Like people are in medieval times used to see it as miracles, because again, you know, it's baffling to think that in the middle of a dry desert there is a water body. But do you know what is the logic behind that? Anyone?
What, sir? You said they are digging deep inside.
Yeah. So these oases basically, so deserts have terrains. So these oases are present in the areas of deserts which are very low, and when they are very low, they actually reach some or the other openings from the ground. So desert is not desert throughout. It's not 64 kilometers of crust that is desert. You know, how do deserts form? The upper layer actually becomes so dry that it disintegrates into individual sand particles. Okay, and that sand particles over time becomes more and more and more drier, and just becomes so light that it can be carried away with, that's called erosion, and there is nothing to hold on to it. That's why trees are important. Trees always bind with soil and do not let it become desert. How many of you have heard about Thar desert of India?
I have heard.
Yes, sir.
Yes, yes. Thar desert of India is not a natural desert, you know? There are evidences now suggesting that it was formed due to excessive deforestation near that region where it meets with, you know, so one, there are very few water bodies or no water body going through that. So once you start cutting trees at a very rapid rate, so there are evidences that it's a man-made desert. Other deserts, like bigger deserts like Sahara in Africa, you know, at one point of time, Sahara was at the bottom of the sea. It was the bottom of the sea. And how do we know that? How can we know that something was at the bottom of the sea? Very simply.
Accumulation of sand.
By
accumulation of sand particles.
Because, but when it becomes a desert, it's already so dry that everything is just the sand particles. So it's dry sand particles. Something else that can tell us?
Underground water.
No, nothing. Nothing related with water. Nothing related with sand. Something else.
By digging it.
What happens when we dig it? You are going the right way. Now, come on, think as a scientist. What we will find when we will dig a desert, and if that desert was once in the bottom of the sea, was the base of the sea. So you know, the earth crust is constantly moving, it's not static. There is something called tectonic plates, and they are moving around.
Yes,
they are moving very slow. So every year, Asian subcontinent, the Asia, Japan and Asia, Asia is moving towards Japan around 11 inches every year. Now, 11 inch every year is very slower rate, but still it's moving. And how do we know that? We know that through satellite data, where we can do the geo tracking. Similarly, things have moved, and when they move, so sometimes two plates collide with each other and one goes on the top of other. So it's like two things are colliding and exerting force against each other. So someone will go at the top, right? Makes sense. And this is how mountains are also formed. But a desert was once at the bottom of the sea. To find that, if you dig in enough and you find fossils of fish and bigger whale-like organisms, will it tell you that whale can never be a desert animal, right?
Yes.
Whale or bigger fish-like organisms must always have been in the sea. So how come they find their fossils in a desert? because that desert is now a desert because the tectonic plates moved and it's out of the sea base. But at one point of time, it was in the sea. Is it making sense to you?
Yes, sir.
And the evidence that we dig deep enough and we found fossils of whale-like organisms or shark-like organisms, their skeleton, it tells us that this was once a water body. Okay. So why I started this? Okay. So since light cannot reach the deeper levels, so organisms have to evolve to survive in that stagnant water. And this euglenoids have done beautifully. So what euglenoids can do is they can be photosynthetic autotrophs during the daytime when some or the other sunlight is available. And when sunlight is not available, especially during the nighttime, they can convert into heterotrophs. So write down. In the presence of sunlight, they behave as photosynthetic autotrophs. And in the absence of sunlight, they behave like heterotrophs. Now, in the absence of sunlight, what kind of heterotrophs they will be? What will they do? When sunlight is not present and they cannot make their own food, what they can do? They can predate on other smaller organisms, right?
Yes, sir.
So they show predatory behavior. They show predatory behavior. Now, if you see these two features, you remember before I started Kingdom Protista, I told you that some organisms in Kingdom Protista, by latest research, are known as the ancestors of animals and plants. So euglenoids are kind of that connecting link. Do you see that they can photosynthesize like higher plants? This is a feature of higher plants, right? They can also predate like higher animals, predatory. And when I say predate, I mean, it's not, how is predation different from parasitism? Tell me. Anyone, the word predator and parasite, how are they different? The logic is in the terminology. Yes, Maria.
We go looking for them.
We go looking for what?
The things that we want to eat.
So that
to
is
predate
what?
On them.
Yes, right. So predators actively search. That parasites also do. Parasites also actively search for the host. So we going looking is correct, but still there is something more logical than that. You're on the right track. Anyone else? Or you? Nida, Omar, Ishita, Rehab. What is the difference between predating and being a parasite?
Predators hunt their food and parasites like they stuck on the host.
Yes. Right. This is what Mariam said exactly.
Yeah, I think so. Mariam said this.
Yes. Yeah, so say something different because that I have already discarded as a B grade answer. Give me an A grade answer.
Predator can kill.
Predators can kill. Parasites can also kill. If they increase in number, they will infect so much that the organism will die.
Predators are more dangerous and merciless.
But what is dangerous? Like dangerous looking? Like a
no. Like they are merciless, right? How they are killing.
Parasites are not merciful. Parasites are not like, oh, so poor. Parasites also are, there's something very evidently
parasite,
different.
Parasite gets its nutrition from other organisms from its host.
Yeah.
While the predators preys on
other organisms.
Yes. Yeah.
Again, the same. Parasites depend on other organisms and predators depend on other organisms. How is this a difference at all? How? It's like a laptop works on electricity and a PC also works on electricity. Wow. What is the difference between predator and parasite? See, this is such a basic question because, see, just think. You will get to know the answer. Imagine a parasite.
Can I say one thing? Yeah, like predators, like if we see their.
What happened? Your voice is breaking. Is it breaking?
Predators are like, they are huge animals type. And parasites. Hello, sir. Is it clear now?
Perfect.
Yeah.
predators, as the word says, always has to be bigger and stronger than the prey they are predating on. Most of the times.
I've seen it in Discovery Channel.
See, watching Discovery brings you close to biology and will help you get one or two marks in your entrance to become a doctor. Good. So predators always either have to be bigger than their preys, or they should live in groups, a colony. You know, there can be smaller predators also, like ants. Ants, sometimes they predate, right? Have you seen a colony of ants taking a cockroach away?
Yes. Yeah.
Anything dead, and if there are enough ants, they will just come together and they will either do two things. They will dismantle that body and take one small parts, you know, or together they will try to lift it. And because ants can lift a lot of weight as compared to their own body weight, they will carry. So if you see a cockroach, which is at least 20 to 50 times bigger than a small ant, many ants will be carrying it away. So there the flock behavior of predators come into picture. But most of the natural predators are actually bigger and stronger as compared to their prey, so that they can hunt it, kill it, and feed on it. Whereas parasites, as the word parasite says, you know, there's a movie also, a good Hollywood movie called Parasite. The notion behind that is parasites have to be very, very discreet and hideous and small. If there is a parasite as big as the host, it cannot be a parasite. Can you imagine a louse or a tapeworm the size of a human living inside the human or living on the top of human? No, right? So all our ectoparasites also can be of two types, and I'll tell you here only. One is called ectoparasite, just like ectotoxin and endotoxin and exotoxin. So ecto means outside. Give me some example of ectoparasites.
Lice.
So lice are always smaller, ticks, you know. And endoparasites? Endoparasites are tapeworm, which live inside the intestines of human. And liver fluke lives inside the liver, and we don't know about it because they are so small, they can just hide between the liver cells and muscles. So that's why parasites have to be smaller. So if they are predatory, their predatory behavior comes from higher organisms. You know, they being very small feed on even smaller organisms, and that behavior is called predatory behavior. You understand the difference between parasite, predation?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now write down. The pigments responsible for, so this connects them to higher animals. Photosynthesis connects them to higher plants, but just by the ability of doing photosynthesis, it does not mean that they connect to plants. Remember, I told you there are certain bacteria that can do photosynthesis?
Yes, sir.
And there are more than one pigment responsible for it?
Yes, sir.
Which is the most abundant pigment for photosynthesis? What A?
Chlorophyll A.
Chlorophyll A. There are chlorophyll B, carotenoids, xanthanoids, all different classes. But if we are saying that something is related to plants, we have to check for the pigment that is carrying out its photosynthesis. So write down the pigments responsible for photosynthesis in euglenoids. The pigments responsible for photosynthesis in euglenoids are identical to those present in higher plants. Bracket may write down chlorophyll A and chlorophyll B being the major ones. Okay, done writing?
Yes, sir.
Now a question arises. Plants are higher life forms and they have chlorophyll A. Okay. Euglenoids are lower life forms. They also have chlorophyll A. So if someone asks you what evolved earlier, the ability to photosynthesize or plants, what will you say?
Ability to photosynthesize.
Exactly. So plants photosynthesis does not evolve with plants. It evolved way before plants evolved. And this is an example, or this is a proof of that. Euglenoids are a proof of that. Similarly, predation as a behavior did not arise when animals evolved. It evolved before that through euglenoids. Is it clear to you? Now, can you appreciate why euglenoids, and in general, because euglenoids come under protista. Why protista and euglenoid is known as the link or ancestors of higher plants and higher animals?
Yes,
this
sir.
Question has come once. I have seen it in the 2014 NEET, when NEET started, that which are the closest ancestors to animals. And there are four options given, and protista was one of it. And even if under protista there are options, then euglenoid will be the answer, right? So if the options are slime mold, euglenoids, dinoflagellates, and protozoans, what will you say?
Euglenoids.
Okay, very good. And the example is this. So that's why Euglena is one example, and Euglena is the most studied example. There are other examples, but no one of those examples have ever been asked in any of your questions. So just remember Euglena. And go and look for the diagram of Euglena in your textbook. Though the diagram does not come, they are very simple. They are just organisms which look like this. And at one end, there is flagella, one bigger, one smaller. And inside, there'll be a big stalk of chlorophyll. So Euglena will look green because of chlorophyll deposition in it. If you see it under the microscope, you will think that it's a plant because it will look green of chlorophyll. But that chlorophyll is only active during the day, and during the night, these Euglena switch to predatory mode and go and start killing and eating the smaller part, organisms like bacteria and other single cell organisms in the water body. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. What else have been asked? What do you need to know? So write down. Okay, that's not important. Okay, that's all we'll cover for Euglena. That's important for your boards as well as your entrances. So now we move on to the next category under protista, which is called slime molds. So I hope you are you keep marking the highlight points of every category that we are studying.
Yes, sir.
Okay, that's very good. Now, let's come to slime molds. Now, the word slime, you must have heard the word slime as an adjective. Sometimes we define certain fluids and we say that this fluid is very slimy or sticky. You remember?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So first thing is that these slime molds are saprophytic. The important thing is that they are saprophytic in nature. And what do we mean by saprophytic? Saprophyte means, the word sapro means?
Feed on decay.
Yes.
Dead and decay.
Yes. So they depend on dead and decaying organisms. Phytic is the mode of nutrition. You know, wherever the word phyto or phytic comes, it's the mode of nutrition or nutrition. So saprophytic is which depends on dead and decaying matter for their nutrition. Okay. And this is the characteristic feature of slime molds under protista. Before this, all the protists that you have studied, chrysophytes, dinoflagellates, and euglenoids, they were not saprophytic. Remember?
Yes.
This is the first saprophytic. Slime mold is a saprophytic protist. And have you seen, how many of you have visited dense forest areas or woody areas? Dense jungles or something like Jim Corbett or your wildlife safari. Has someone done something like that? Or have you seen them on Discovery? Dense forest,
yes,
footages,
sir,
of dense forest? Okay, good. So Discovery is your mode for exploring the world. Good. So you must have seen that these trees in the dense forest, they are big. And at the base, towards the base of the trees, there is greenish deposition, which takes
yes,
over
sir.
The trees. right? The trees are not like the trees we see around us. So these things are these slime molds which grow on any surface, because these trees will, as they will grow, the outer layer starts dying. Normally, the if you see the bark of any tree you talk about, which is very prominent in India or any tropical subcontinent, the outer layers of the tree is dead. Remember, which is called the bark. It's dead.
Yes, sir.
You can just take it out as wood and can burn it. So slowly, when these bark layers starts dying, so there are newer layers which are being formed on the interior, in the inside of the tree. So these slime molds starts feeding on that dead and decaying matter, because it's dying and it will decay, and they will rapid the process because they secrete some enzymes that rapids or ramps up the decaying process. That's why they are called saprophytes. So write down, saprophytes can move along, saprophytes can move along decaying leaves, decaying leaves, twigs, wood, etc. So whenever a tree falls, if a tree falls in the jungle, you know, after a few years, that tree will be gone. No one took it anywhere. The tree just disappeared, vanished. So if you went to a jungle, you saw a fallen tree, then you went after 5 years, the tree will not be there. Where did the tree go?
Decomposed.
Yes, it got decayed by these slime molds. So these slime molds take over and they walk. When I say move, they actually are moving. But to see their movement, you know, Discovery, all these channels sometimes also show you some footages which are actually a time lapse. So they move very slow. But you keep a camera there and leave the camera for, let's say, 7 days. And when you get all the footage, just speed it up. And when you will speed it up, you will see a certain kind of slimy material coming and taking over the tree and slowly decomposing it altogether. Those materials are called slime molds. So you can go to internet today, go back and look for the, let me just see if I can get it here. Oh, we are on internet. Why am I not? What can you see on my screen? Can you still see the notebook?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Slime mold. Let me check for if I can find. By the time, okay, let's first complete it, then I'll see if I can find that and show you. But if I cannot show you, go to internet and look for slime molds fast time lapse videos. There are beautiful videos showing all sorts of slime molds growing and moving over a dead or a decaying tree. Okay. Then you will appreciate that. So what you have written, they slowly move along decaying leaves, twigs, wood, etc., engulfing the organic material. Engulfing the organic material. Okay. So this is their specialty. That's why they are called slime molds. Now, slime molds basically, write down under. So what they do is they can do two things. Their mode of survival varies in a favorable versus an unfavorable condition. Just like bacteria. What do bacteria do in a favorable condition? It divides rapidly, right? And what does it do during unfavorable condition? I told you. Anyone? Neda, Rehab, Omar, not saying anything. A bacteria during a favorable condition divides, but during an unfavorable condition, what does it do? Remember, I told you it does something. It makes a cyst around itself, remember? It makes a hard covering around itself and stops dividing and protect itself till the situation is favorable again. Did I tell you this? Did I not tell you this? See, tell me, told already. Sorry. No, I have not. So you have to tell me that I have not told you this. Sometimes because I may get confused if something I have told between batches, but okay, if I have not told you. So in a favorable condition, a bacteria divides repeatedly. But under an unfavorable condition, it stops dividing, makes a cyst around itself. So cyst is an additional layer, which, so there is a cell membrane, then comes a cell wall, and even on that cell wall, they start making cysts, very hard structures, and they become metabolically inactive inside it. They just go on a long sleep, just like hibernation and aestivation. Hibernation we have discussed, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes. But slime molds, instead of becoming inactive, they have found a way. So write down, during unfavorable conditions, they produce spores. At their tips. And these slime molds, they do not have cell wall, okay? So slime molds do not have cell wall because they are very slimy and squishy. But when they produce spores, write down, the spores have true cell walls. Now these spores have cell walls, and these cell walls make these spores extremely resistant. And it makes sense, right? Because if the condition is unfavorable, you would like to produce something which is resistant, extremely resistant, right? And it can survive under a lot of adverse conditions. So they are extremely resistant under adverse conditions. Okay. And these spores are tiny spherical structures which can actually be dispersed around by wind. So wind helps in its dispersion. Okay, wind helps in its dispersion. Or another word used is air current. Sometime in textbook they use the word air currents. So air currents are simply like, just there are water currents, and this current is just flow. Current means flow, right?
When we talk about
electric current in physics, you must have studied, what is electric current? Flow of charges. What is water current? Flow of that water. Air current is flow of air. Okay. So current means flow. So this is what they do under unfavorable conditions. They still do not give up. They do not become still. These extremely resistant spores can survive. And once these spores land somewhere, so what air takes it away and they land somewhere. And if they land at a place where condition is still adverse, they will stay like that. And if the condition is favorable, then these spores again becomes a slime mold. You know, so the cell wall breaks and the slime mold comes out and grows in size enormously. Write down, during a favorable condition or suit. What happens during favorable conditions? So during favorable conditions, I already told you that they can move, but very slowly. But that movement happens because of a special structure called plasmodium. Where have you else studied the word plasmodium?
Cell chapter.
Cell. That was plasma membrane. That was not plasmodium. That was plasma membrane. Remember I told you plasmodium?
Then
what? Them what?
I don't know.
Do you know what causes malaria?
Plasmodium.
Plasmodium, yes.
So, and it's a pathogen which is carried by mosquito.
And female mosquitoes.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah, so mosquitoes do not cause malaria. So people often think that mosquitoes cause malaria and dengue and chikungunya. No. Mosquitoes are simply the carriers. And how are they carriers? And because they can only transfer malaria from one infected person to another. So when they feed on the blood, when they suck a human's blood, if this plasmodium or all these pathogens are present in your blood, which means you are infected, they will just take it through your blood. And when they bite another person, you know, so these plasmodium, what they do is they actually enter their gut and start living in their saliva, in mosquito saliva. Okay. Now it's very interesting. Mosquito salivary glands contains a chemical which does not allow the blood to clot. Have you ever seen that when blood comes out of the body, it clots?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, if there is a drop of blood on the floor, it does not remain liquid. It solidifies very fast. It clots. So why is it not clotting inside our own body? Have you ever thought? What happens if blood clots in our body?
I have heard that it can cause the death also.
Yes, it will cause the death for sure because blood will stop moving. It is a liquid tissue. If it clots, it stops moving. Remember I told you about venom and toxins?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
And in that, I told you about venom. And some venom are like, they affect our blood. Some
yes,
blood,
sir.
Some snakes, when they bite you, it's called that they are containing hemotoxic material. Or hemotoxin. So toxins can be of two types, venom and poison. Remember? So they are called hemotoxin,
yes,
and heme means blood. So wherever the word heme comes or hemo comes, it is related to blood. It is hemotoxic. It is a toxin which affects the blood. If it is hemoglobin, it is a molecule, it is a protein which is associated with blood. You know what is hemoglobin?
Red blood cells.
No, hemoglobin are present
pigment.
On red. Yes, it's a pigment. It's a protein.
It's a red pigment.
Which gives our blood red color. Perfect. So if it's hemotoxic, it's a toxin related to blood. It's a hemoglobin. It's a pigment or a protein related to blood. If it is hemophilia, this word also you must have heard. Hemophilia is a disease. Okay. So hemophilia is, I'll talk about this. We'll study this disease in genetics chapter. But remember the word hemo, go to your terminology section. And write it there, it's always related to blood. Similarly, blood clots outside the human veins because we produce certain things that keep it. Whenever it comes in contact with oxygen, it coagulates normally outside the body. So there are some things called anticoagulants. Anticoagulants. Anti means against. Coagulants means coagulation. Coagulation is solidifying of the blood. So these anticoagulant chemicals are present in the saliva of a mosquito. So do you know when mosquito bites a person, when it is piercing the proboscis in the person, there is a slight pain. Have you encountered mosquito bite in your life? You must have, right? Mosquitoes are there everywhere. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
So talk about mosquitoes. Mosquitoes are very common and very important organisms also from ecological point of view. So when they bite, they don't bite. They just insert their proboscis like an injection needle. Exactly like an injection needle. But the difference is in an injection needle, when we pierce, we start sucking things into the capillary. But mosquito first, it's like kind of a, it puts its saliva into the body first. Because that saliva will make the blood around that bite area not coagulate. It will keep the blood in liquid form. That is called an anticoagulant chemical. These anticoagulant chemicals are also present in something called leech. You know what is a leech? In dense forest, there are small organisms that stick to the skin and suck the blood. Blood suckers. Black or brown in color. They are called leech. And their scientific name, because now you know how scientific names are done, their scientific name is Hirudinaria. And this name comes from a word called hirudin. This hirudin is a chemical. It's an anticoagulant chemical. The same chemical that is often used in have you seen an injection, a new injection, not the needle but the injection cavity? So once you take something in an injection, then you immediately transfer it in a small vial. When they take your blood for blood test, they put it in a small vial like this, right, which has a rubber cork on the top, and there is a label where they write your name and things. And in this, you can store the blood as liquid forever, because the inner surface of this vial is actually layered with an anticoagulant chemical, which will not affect the composition or anything which is present in the blood. It will just not allow blood to coagulate. Make sense to you?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so there's a lot of science actually happening around you, which you are unaware of. Okay, so when it's favorable, so they aggregate. Plasmodium, write down, it's an aggregate. It's an aggregate or a collision of slime molds. It's an aggregate or collision of slime molds. And this plasmodium is different from the plasmodium that we were talking about, which is the causative agent of malaria, because this plasmodium it can be several feet long. Now, very clearly, the plasmodium that is in our body is not several feet long, but this plasmodium, which is an aggregate of slime mold, can be several feet long. That's how they cover the entire tree. You understand?
Yes.
Okay. So what you have to remember from and yes. So what you have to remember for this particular category is, so questions often come on their nutrition. They are saprophytic, and to stay saprophytic, they move very slow over these organic material and engulf it. And before engulfing, they secrete some chemicals which digest the material, right? That's why they are found on the bark or dead trees in very dense forests. And they have different set of functioning in favorable and unfavorable conditions. During the favorable condition, they make aggregates, which are called plasmodiums, which can be several feet long and can cover all the dead and decaying matter and engulf it. And when unfavorable conditions appear, they actually produce spores at the tip of their buds. And these spores then burst, and a lot of small, tiny particles disperse in the air. And they are extremely resistant and protected by a true cell wall. So a question has come that at what time in a slime mold's life cycle, cell wall appears. So it appears as spores. When they are in the form of spores, they have cell walls. Apart from that, they never have cell walls. So are you appreciating that protista is a mixture of a lot of different characteristic features?
Yes, sir.
So till now, we have studied slime molds, chrysophytes, dinoflagellates, and euglenoids. And you must have understood that all four are very different from each other. So it's like protista sometimes is called the storehouse kingdom. When something does not fit in any other kingdom like fungi, plantae, animalia, or monera, we put it under protista, making a different category. Do you understand that? So it is the go-to kingdom for biologists till now. That's why the question comes that which is the only kingdom with no defined boundaries? That is
Protestant.
Is it clear to everyone? Any doubts till now?
No, sir.
No?
No, sir.
We have Nida, Omar, Ishita?
No, sir.
Okay. Please speak up. Please. Is the class boring? I can sing you a song if you want.
No, sir. I'm writing down.
No, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So if you find it boring, just start talking, you know, because if you are engaged, and I'm trying to make it discussive and engaging you with real life examples, because that is how you can appreciate biology. Okay. So this is all that they will, and I'm not overloading you with information you don't need to know. So it's already more than what you have in your textbooks, because it's also covering some questions from your entrances, and we will do that for every segment. Okay. Now, the last category that we have to study in Protista is protozoans, protozoa, or protozoans. They are also called like protozoans sometimes. Okay. Now, what are protozoans? So write down, all protozoans are heterotrophs. Now, the first exclusive heterotroph of the kingdom. We saw a connecting link between the two, which was euglenoids. Then we saw saprophytes. Before that, we saw autotrophs, photosynthetic and non-photosynthetic. And now we are seeing complete heterotrophs. So write down, all protozoans are heterotrophs and can either live as... Is my audio clear to all of you?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So all of them are heterotrophs. So why is Zoom giving me a signal that your voice call clarity may go down? Okay. So all protozoans are heterotrophs, and they can either... And heterotrophs are of... Remember I told you protists are connected to animals. So either they can be predators, if they are big enough, or they can be parasites if they are small. Okay. So protozoans can either be predators or parasites. And write down about protozoans, because these features are only present in animals. These are animal-like features, right? They have no plant-like features. So write down, protozoans are considered to be ancestors, primitive ancestors. There are many words that are used: primitive ancestors, primitive relatives, or primitive animals. So they are ancestors to animals. Also write the term primitive so you know. Now understand this. It does not necessarily mean that all the animals today have evolved from protozoans. Whenever in evolution we say that something is an ancestor of something, it does not mean that all of the current thing has come from that something. Or when we say something is linked, remember in the very early of my classes I told you that we have not evolved from chimpanzees. We have also not evolved from monkeys. We were never chimpanzees. We were never monkeys. We were Homo sapiens right from the beginning. We were human beings. Now, what evolution tells is that before human beings inhabited the earth, there were completely different species, which then bifurcated and gave rise to independent chimpanzees and independent Homo sapiens. So it's called divergence in evolution. There's a connecting link, and that connecting link was neither like chimpanzees nor like human beings. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Because when we diverged as a species, remember the definition of species? Species are capable of interbreeding, right?
Yes, sir.
So Homo sapiens are capable of interbreeding with Homo sapiens in nature only, even though our genetic material matches the chimpanzee's genetic material 99%. even slightly more than that. So even with 99% of same gene, we still have a lot of differences, and that comes from that 1% that is not matching, and which means that we never evolved from them. It can never happen that after 10 million years, all the chimpanzees of the planet Earth will become humans. No, they will always stay chimpanzees. Similarly, protozoans are still living on the planet with animals, right? So when I say that they are ancestors to animals, it means they were the connecting links from where divergence happened. One group remained protozoans and one group bifurcated somewhere. You understand?
Yes, sir.
We will study evolution and genetics in detail and all their proofs and evidences later, but just remember that when I say something evolved from something, what does it mean? Write down. Now, for protozoans are very important for your study, and a lot of time they are causative agents, because you remember this one thing which I said, they are parasites. If they are parasitic in nature, they will be parasites to every other bigger organism, right? So they are also parasites to humans. And a lot of diseases happen due to protozoans. So write down, protozoans can majorly be divided in four groups. Protozoans can majorly be divided in four groups. Now, these four groups are important from your entrance point of view because they talk about diseases. First is amoeba-like protozoans, or they are called amoeboid protozoans. Amoeboid protozoans. As the name suggests, all amoeba-like, you must have drawn structure of amoeba, right? In your biology classes. So what are some features of amoeba?
They are unicellular organisms.
Yes, so there's a single cell.
They do not have different shape.
Very easy to draw, like, right? Because any shape you draw, it's an amoeba. Amoeba has no shape, they are shapeless. And they often move, projecting these projections out. So if there is a food material, amoeba is also predatory, right? So there's a small food material, there's a small, let's say a bacteria or something, unicellular organism present. So these big unicellular organisms, they engulf it in a cavity like this. And this thing that which they project out is known as pseudopodia. Remember this
pseudopodia
name?
Yes, sir.
Yes, don't forget your prior knowledge. You know, it's important. Now, the word again. What are the word pseudo means?
Fake.
Fake or false. And the word poda or podia means?
Feet.
Yes, feet or appendages. So I'm writing feet for clarity. Appendages. If I say arthropoda, the word poda in arthropoda means? Feet or appendages, feet. Same. So word podia, poda means feet or appendages. So they are like false feet. So they extend it outwards as if they are using it to move, but they are just false extensions. They always do this to engulf a prey, and then the shape distorts, the shape changes to something else. So write down in amoeboid protozoans, just write down few things that are important and have been asked. One is, so they are freshwater organisms. They are freshwater organisms, marine water organisms, as well as soil dwellers, moist soil dwellers. So they can be found everywhere. They can be found in freshwater, like your lakes. Sometimes, have you seen that people catch dysentery and diarrhea after drinking water from a lake or a pond?
Yes.
That kind of dysentery or diarrhea often is diagnosed by doctors as amoebic dysentery. That is a disease that many of us have, those who travel a lot and drink water from different natural sources, often have higher chance to catch amoebic dysentery. So that amoebic word comes from this protozoa. So this is present in fresh water that causes dysentery. And it's also present in moist soil. And I've already told you about pseudopodia. They use pseudopodia as an extension to catch their prey. They use pseudopodia as an extension to catch their prey. And one more important thing is the ones which live in fresh water, you know, they do not have cell wall. Okay. But the ones who live in seawater or marine water, they have cell wall. And why is this cell wall important? Is because this is a single like organism, a small unicellular organism, which actually depends a lot on osmosis, or the term is osmoregularity. You know what is osmoregularity means? What is osmosis? Osmosis. We have actually discussed diffusion.
Movement of water from high concentration to lower concentration.
Perfect. That's osmosis. Now, osmoregularity means regulating that osmosis simply. So every aquatic organisms regulate the flow of water. It should not happen. See, if it is a single cell, the single cell must be having a lot of things inside it for nutrition. It must be having sugar, protein, lot of nucleotides, DNA material, and other things inside the body, right? Which will not be present in a, which will not be present in the abundance in the outside water environment, right? So if you see the pressure of water, where the pressure of water is more, outside or inside?
Inside.
Outside. Inside. Outside. Water is more outside. Inside, there are other things along with water. So whenever we dissolve something in water, the pressure, the partial pressure of water is less. It gets shared. For example, there are two glasses of there are two glasses in which in one there is just water, and in the other with this in the same volume there is water plus sugar. So in this glass the pressure from inside is divided into two things, sugar and water. The volume is same, so the partial pressure of water is more or less here. Here. Is it more or less?
Less.
Less. If I connect these two glasses by a pipe, the movement of water will take, if there is a permeable membrane, semi-permeable, let's say there's a plasma membrane, the movement of water will take place from the pure water to the water plus sugar solution. You understand? And the movement of sugar will take place from this to this, because there is no sugar here. So the partial pressure of sugar is more. Do you understand? Whenever yes, we dissolve something in water, the partial pressure is also taken up by the thing which is getting dissolved, that we call solute. In chemistry, 10th class, you must have read these terms, solute and solvent together makes a solution. Am I
yes,
right?
Sir. Yes, sir.
You must have also done that one experiment, raisin experiment, where you keep a raisin in water overnight and the raisin bloats up.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Everyone has done it? So what is happening during that bloating up of raisin? Water is in the raisin, right? Because inside, water content was less. What was more inside? What was inside the raisin? Raisin is basically a dried up grape where the water is very minimum. And what is more? Sugar. You understand?
Yes, sir.
Right. So sugar will move from the raisin to outside. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So this is how movements, osmosis takes place. So if this organism cannot regulate the flow of water, what will happen? Water will keep coming in, right? Am I correct?
Yes, sir.
If water will keep coming in a fresh water system, See, I'm making you understand the concept. In a fresh water, water will keep coming in and then organism will burst. So it has to maintain its osmoregularity, right? What happens in a seawater? Now imagine this thing. In a seawater, it's not just water. What is dissolved with water?
Salts.
Yes, water plus a lot of salts. Very high concentration of salt is there. So what happens if an amoeba is living in a salty water? Where will water move from to from? What will the direction of motion of water normally? Whatever water is present inside will start moving
outside.
Outside. And the organism will shrink and die. So it has to maintain a check. It should not allow, it should not lose water. Have you seen, it is said that even if you are stuck in the middle of the sea, to survive, never drink seawater. You will die faster if you drink seawater. Have you heard this or not?
Yes, sir.
So why will we, and what will be the cause of death? If a person drinks a lot of seawater, the person will die. But what will be the cause of death?
Dehydration.
Exactly. Very interestingly, right, Ishita? Very interestingly, it will be dehydration. Now, this doesn't make sense. The person drank water and died of dehydration. Why? Because that water was so salty that when it entered the stomach, from stomach, it should go into the blood, right? Water should have, from the stomach or intestine, it should have absorbed into the blood vessels, where then from there, it should have gone to each and every tissue of our body, right? Am I correct?
Yes, sir.
But the opposite happens. When it reaches our stomach and intestines, water that should have gone from intestines to blood, actually what happens, water from blood comes into the intestines. So our intestines bloat, our stomachs bloat, and we feel like full, not thirsty, but we feel always thirsty. We are full, but we are thirsty, and we die of dehydration because all our tissues and our muscles and our blood and all our organs lose water. Do you understand? That's why we should never drink marine water in the sea. That's why it said that control your thirst and your urge to drink it. You may survive longer with the water which is already present in your body. You may survive for 2 or 3 or 4 days. You may get subconscious or unconscious, but may not die. But if you drink that water, that sea water, you will die within hours. Now, is it making sense why it happens?
Yes, sir.
Perfect. So just to maintain this thing, the amoeba which is living in seawater has a cell wall, so it can protect the flow of water from it to the outside. Okay, so write down, marine amoeboid protozoans have a cell wall. And if I ask you logically, just tell me which cell wall will be the best for this function. We do not want anything to go out. If you were an amoeba, which cell wall will you choose? Now you have options. A flexible proteinaceous layer, which is called pellicle. A silicate layer made up of silica, indestructible. You will choose a chitin, a peptidoglycan, which is a polysaccharide, or a cellulose cell wall. Which one will you choose?
Silica.
Mariam will choose silica. Others? Aisha?
Chitin.
Chitin. Okay. Omar, Nida, Rehab, Ishita.
Silica.
Nida will go for silica. Rehab, Omar, Ishita.
Even I will go for that.
Sir, what was the second option?
So there are all sorts of cell wall which we have studied are present in the biological world. First is this pellicle that we have just studied above, a protein layer, which gives flexibility. Second is silica, which we studied in diatoms, which is indestructible, very hard shells. Then there are bacterial cell walls made up of polysaccharides, and plant cell wall made up of cellulose, and fungi cell wall made up of chitin. So which one you think will suit the purpose well? We do not want to dehydrate as amoeba. Which one will you choose?
Sir, chitin.
Chitin. Ishita?
Chitin.
Chitin. Okay, people are changing sides now. Okay. I see. Omar. Omar is like, give me any cell wall, I will work with that.
I was gonna choose silica, but
silica. But my other batchmates are choosing chitin, so I should go for the.
No, sir. No.
Sir, I will choose both.
Who will choose both?
I will choose both.
Aisha, you cannot choose both, right? What, you want half of your cell wall of silica and half of chitin? It does not work like that. See whichever suits you the best.
It's silica.
Okay, for you also it's silica. For Omar, it's silica. For Mariam, did you change sides? Or you are with silica?
Yes, sir. Chitin.
You changed to chitin. Sir.
Okay. Sir, I will take chitin.
Ishita will also be with chitin, right? Or silica?
Chitin.
Chitin. Omar.
Sir, I will take chitin.
Who will take chitin? Aisha.
Yes.
Aisha is getting influenced by Mariam. Okay, fine. Nida and Rehab. Rehab, you'll go.
Chitin.
Rehab is going with chitin. Nida.
Silica.
So we have.
Sir, I am alone, sir.
No, Nida is with you. Omar, you are silica, right? Nida is for silica and everyone else is for chitin, right? Now the person who will give the right answer will get nothing. And the right answer is, but knowledge. The right answer is silica.
Hey, I took silica only.
No. You changed to chitin. So silica actually serves the purpose well because silica is impermeable, you know? And if it's impermeable, like, so there are smaller pores which can allow something to come in. But when you have to put something out without your decision, you know, silica is the best barrier because silica will give you a chance to reabsorb it. Whenever it goes outside your membrane, you can reabsorb it again because silica will hold it for some time. So silica or silicate, write down, marine amoeboids or marine amoeba forms silica shells on their surface. The problem with chitin is, and I can understand why many of you went with chitin, is because chitin is waterproof, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
The exoskeleton of insects is made up of chitin as well. Was that a reason for you to go for chitin? If that was a reason, that was not a very wrong reason. So your logics were right. But again, chitin is actually, it's destructible and can dissolve in water. So one thing which you did not thought of is all the insects and fungi live on land, right? They do not live in water. If insects were to live in water, so all the crustaceans that live in water, which have shells on their body, it is not chitinous, it is calcium cells. Because calcium can stay as a solid in, even inside water as calcium carbonate, you know? Or otherwise it has to be silica. Both chitin and cellulose will dissolve over a period of time or will be weaker. Do you understand? So your waterproof logic was slightly correct, but then you forgot that they are living inside the water. Till when they can be waterproof? And they have to deal with water. So silica, they make silica shells on their surface. And there is one such important organism, which is called ant amoeba. It's and how do you write amoeba? Ant amoeba. Now, ant amoeba is a very big amoeba. You can see it with your naked eye, even like very tiny dot, but in the microscope, it looks very big. So ant amoeba is a parasite. It's a very well-known parasite. And it causes amoebic dysentery. Amoebic dysentery is where you get loose motions due to drinking water bodies contaminated with ant amoeba. Okay. So this was the first group, amoeboid protozoans. What you have to understand about amoeboid protozoans is that they are present everywhere. They are amoeba-like. They are amoeba only. They give rise to pseudopodia. And when they are outside the marine water or in the soil, they do not have a cell wall. But when they are inside the marine water, they need a cell wall to control their osmoregularity, right? And the cell wall is made up of silica because silica does the best job to not allow loss of water. And ant amoeba is an example that comes often in your questions, exams. and it's a parasite that can live inside your gut and cause amoebic dysentery. Clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
This is all you need to know about this first category. Now let's go to second category. Right on, second categories is flagellated protozoans. Protozoans with flagella. Now, one thing which is coming more and more often in Kingdom Protista is flagella. Flagella was also present in dinoflagellates. The name suggests it. Flagella was also present in euglenoids. But there was a difference between dinoflagellates flagella and euglenoids flagella. In dinoflagellates, there were two flagella, one on the transverse axis and one on the longitudinal axis. In euglenoids, there were two flagella again, but one was smaller, one was bigger, and both were in the same axis. Now we talk about flagellated protozoans. So for this to be clear, just write down the first point. They have one single flagella. They have one single flagella. And they are either parasitic, they have one single flagella, and they are either parasitic or free living. So these are the first kind of protozoans that are either free living. When I say free living, what does it mean? What does free living mean? Simple word, free living.
Living freely.
Wow.
No exact rules.
Yes, what?
No exact rules.
No?
Exact rules.
Exact rules. Yes. Exactly, and no exact roles also. So they do not have to depend on some other thing. So they live freely in water. And even if they get into someone's body as a parasite, if they are free living, they will not do something. They'll just come out of the body or they will die inside the body, get digested. So either they are parasitic, which only can survive inside a host, or they are free living, which can survive everywhere and does not depend on a host. Okay, flagellated protozoans. And not much have been asked about this category in exams, apart from this one fact that there is one disease which is very interesting and important disease, which is called sleeping sickness. Have you heard the term sleeping sickness?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So this sleeping sickness is caused by a flagellated protozoan called trypanosoma. Trypanosoma is the agent. And a question, only I have seen the question on this organism because it causes sleeping sickness. So the question often comes like there'll be four protozoans on one side and there'll be four diseases on the other side in entrance. And you have to match the correct. You understand? So trypanosoma causes sleeping sickness. That's all. Apart from this, and trypanosoma, of course, when it causes sleeping sickness in humans, it is a parasitic one, right? It is not free living. That's all. Nothing more important. Everyone clear? Remember the word trypanosoma and sleeping sickness. Now let's come to a ciliated protozoa. Now, as the name suggests, these were having flagella because they were flagellated. So these will have cilia. Okay, so they are ciliated, so cilia. And you know what is the difference between flagella and cilia? Flagella looks something like, where did I draw? Like this, very big extensions, hair-like extensions from the body, either one or two. Whereas cilia looks something like this. So if this is the body of an ciliated, these are tiny hair-like particles covering, in most of the cases, the entire body surface. These are very small. And they are also able to move. They are also able to move or vibrate wherever they are. Now, what do you think this is helping the organism in?
Movement.
So, yes. So, this cilia can help in a lot of other things that flagella cannot do. Flagella can only help in movement, right? But cilia, apart from helping in movement, it can also help in capturing food. Literally, when a food, so in most of these organisms, there is a mouth. So mouth has to be at one place in the body, right? An organism cannot eat from everywhere. There has to be one opening to get things inside, even if it's one cell, right? Am I right?
Yes, sir.
And suppose there is a small food particle that encountered the protozoa here in this region. Now, body's food, mouth is here. The mouth part is here, or mouth-like part. We should not say mouth. Mouth is human-centric. So these cilia, what they will do, will they will start beating in a direction. They have a directional motion. And they will start beating in one direction. And they will push the food right into the mouth. Do you understand? So they are capable of, wherever the food encounters, at wherever body part, they are capable of moving that food particle all through the body axis towards the food, towards the mouth cavity. Is it clear, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Yes, write out.
Yes, sir.
So they are actually moving organs. Again, they are aquatic, but that's, I think you understood it. So I don't have to tell you. They are aquatic. And they are actively motile, because whenever these cilia will beat, the organism will move in one or the other direction. And this organism moves like a gliding pattern. So when there is a flagella, flagella shows a motor-like movement. You understand? A motor-like movement, a rapid movement. But organism with cilia show a gliding movement. You know, they can even change direction, staying at the same place. Can you imagine it? Because cilia can just move like this also in water. So suppose this screen is water, you are seeing me, and my hand is a ciliated protozoan. Let's suppose first my hand is a flagellated protozoan. So it will move something like this. Okay, it will show rapid movement to different places. But a ciliated protozoan can also show movement like this. On the same plane, it can just slide, you know, Michael Jackson dancing, you know, same place, it can just rotate and turn and do all sorts of things. So that ciliated protozoans can do. Apart from active movement in one direction, they can just change the direction, staying there only. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, yes sir.
So write down, they have a mouth cavity, and this part that has been asked sometimes, it has a special name. The name was on the tip of my tongue. I forgot the name. So this mouth cavity has a name which is asked. Okay, I'll tell you when I'll remember. I'll remember it. Don't worry. Let's talk about something else. Oh, it's called gullet. Okay, so this is us. So they have gullet, a characteristic feature. You can mark this as the characteristic feature for this particular category. Ciliated protozoans have a mouth cavity called gullet, and the cilia helps in moving the food towards the gullet. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
And, that's all. So cilia, write down. Just write down. Cilia steers the food towards gullet. So a question has also come on ciliated protozoans. Then what is the use of these cilia? So remember, it's for movement as well as for capturing the food, capturing or transporting the food towards the gullet. So in short, if there are four options given: locomotion, nutrition, reproduction, protection. Which two are correct, or which three is everything correct? Cilia helps in what? Nutrition, locomotion, reproduction, and protection.
Locomotion and nutrition.
Locomotion and protection.
Locomotion and
protection.
Nutrition.
No, not protection. It's not for protection at all. Just now I told you that it steers the food. So it is for nutrition. Nutrition and locomotion. Remember? It's not for protection and not for reproduction. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
You will not get confused. Yes, because most of the times it feels like cilia is protecting because they are on the outer surface like thorns. But they are not protecting. They are helping in locomotion or movement and in nutrition. Okay, or steering the food.
Okay. Sir, what's the movement called for cilia?
Movement called? The movement,
the type of movement.
There's no type of movement. Like movement, sometimes, see, movement can be of different types. One movement can be movement of molecules inside the body. Like food is moving from this part of the cell to this part of the cell. This is also movement, right? But there is, when the term locomotion comes, this term is a special type of movement where the whole body is transporting from one place to another. Just remember this. This will also,
sir, for flagellate, it's motor-like than for cilia.
No, it's not motor-like. For cilia, it's just what you can say. It's slight vibratory movements. They vibrate like small hairs on the surface. So you can write small, very vibratory movement. But there's never a question on. So what I will do is, when I will finish kingdom. So in today's class, I'll finish the kingdom protozoa. And then in the next class, before I start with kingdom fungi, I will prepare a slide for you with all the videos that I wanted to show you, which are important for you to understand the concepts. So I will include everything that you need to show in nature, starting from slime molds to chrysophytes to euglenoids to their predation to the cilia. Will it be fine? Kind of a smart
class. Yes,
okay. So in next class, we'll begin with, please join the classes on time. Don't be late. So in the next class, we'll begin with some videos, okay? I'll keep it ready for you. Okay, so locomotion is where the whole body is transporting from one place to another. Now, this concept is important for plant physiology and animal physiology because in plant, water moves from the roots to the leaves, which sometimes can be meters, 100 meters tall, because there are plants which are 100 meter tall, right? But that will still be called a movement. Movement of water. We will never say locomotion of water. We can say movement or transport of water. But when the whole tree, which it cannot happen, starts moving from one place to another, which happens in case of animals. So animals can show locomotion. Plants cannot show locomotion. But plants can show movement and transportation of all kinds within the body. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Blood moves in our body or transports in our body. Blood never locomotes in our body. We locomote when we go from one place to another. Like Aisha is coming to India. She's locomoting herself. The concept is clear? The language is clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, very good. Now the last one, write down. Sporozoans. Yes, they are asks. Sporozoans. So they are also protozoans. As the word says, sporozoans. The question that have come is, so I already told you that there is one previous stage that we have studied about spores, which comes under slime molds, right? Slime molds have a stage in their life in which they make spores and they are also protista, right? Now, yes, the confusing part is, confusing part is this sporozoans. Now, these sporozoans also have spore stage in their life. But then how are they different from slime molds and why are we not keeping them in slime molds? Because these spores, even in favorable conditions, never become slime molds. Okay, they are distinct organisms, which in their spore form are infectious. So write down. Sporozoans consists of a lot of species of protista. No boundaries. Again, But one thing that I'll highlight, you will star mark it. That is the only thing that can be asked. So sporozoans have a lot of, what have you written? What did you?
Species of protozoa.
It has many different species of protozoans having an infectious spore-like stage, having an infectious spore-like stage in their life cycle. Okay. In their life cycle. Which means that at one point of time in their life, they will be in a spore-like stage, or they will produce spores. And those spores are not like slime mold spores, which are just becoming spores under unfavorable condition for their own benefit. But these spores are capable of causing infection. Slime mold spores are not capable of causing infection. Actually, slime molds are only active when they are in the form of plasmodium, an aggregate. When they are in the form of spores, they are not active, right? But yahan pe, write down, they have an infectious spore-like stage. That is the characteristic feature on which you will be asked questions. Now, do you remember I talked about the causative agent of malaria?
Yes, sir.
That, what is it?
Yes, sir.
Plasmodium, the malaria parasite. That comes under sporozoans. That does not come under slime mold because it's not a slime mold. It has a spore stage. So write down, causative agent of malaria. That's why this kingdom, this category is famous. Causing agent or causative agent of malaria. Is Plasmodium. This is the genus name. And you remember what is Plasmodium? Plasmodium is aggregate. Remember? So in Plasmodium, which causes malaria, all these spores are aggregated, which was opposite in case of slime molds. Do you remember? Please connect with me.
Sir.
Keep revising in your mind what I'm saying. Otherwise, it will be difficult. So Plasmodium comes under sporozoans. It's an infectious pathogen, which means it's neither parasitic nor predatory. It's just an infectious pathogen. So write down, it's a pathogen, an infectious pathogen. And since we are talking about Plasmodium and malaria, I'll also tell you here only about something that's important and will be asked. Do you know where does the malarial pathogen called Plasmodium actually attacks? Which cell does it attack in the body? So it attacks the blood as a tissue, but inside the blood, it attacks the RBCs. Okay, it attacks RBCs. And also, it recognizes RBCs because of its shape. Recognizes, because for something to attack something, you have to recognize. Na? If a pathogen is entering the body, it will encounter a lot of cells, heart cells, platelets, white blood cells, red blood cells, cells of the epithelial layer of blood vessels, cells of liver, heart, kidney, and other organs, right? So how does it know that I only have to infect RBCs? It recognizes the cell surface receptor. Remember, I told you when I was telling you about viruses. Viruses are specific because they can recognize some receptors. And these receptors are present on a RBC, on a normal RBC. And what is the shape of a normal RBC? It's like a donut. A normal RBC looks like this. So this inside is not empty. It's like a not exactly like a donut, but if you see it from the side, it will look like this. Thinner at the center and thicker at the... Can you understand the shape? Can you imagine the shape now in 3D?
Yes, sir.
In your head?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So there's a sweet that comes of this shape called Balushahi. It's like that. Okay. Thinner at the center and thicker at the edges. But still there is something. It's not completely like a donut. It's not empty. It's like this. Okay. So this plasmodium can recognize this shape. Do you know that Africa is the worst hit country from malaria? You know, and therefore Africans have adapted. Africans are actually evolving, and it is the first sign of evolution in humans. Where do you know there is a disease called sickle cell anemia? This we will again come back and study in genetics in detail, because it's a genetic disorder and it happens due to a mutation. So do you know what is a sickle cell anemia? In a sickle cell anemia, sickle, the word sickle comes from the shape. So this shape of RBC changes into this kind of shape. You understand? So this shape is called a sickle shape, tapered at the ends. Sickle is actually a tool which is used to cut the harvest. So this, and because the shape has distorted, the hemoglobin content will also decrease. That's why it's called anemia. Anemia is where less hemoglobin is present. So in Africa, people have started living with this mutation. So this is not a disease there. This is a mutation where half of their cells are like this, and half of their cells are like this in their blood. And what advantage does it gives them? That this plasmodium, the probability of it recognizing is now lowered by half. It cannot recognize these RBCs, right? Because the shape is distorted. Is it making sense to you?
Yes.
Everyone? So this is called a very ingenious way to start living with one disease to tackle another disease. Now with sickle cell anemia, you will not die instantly, right? You only, what will happen is, if you start going up the mountains, you will feel short breath. You will be out of your breath. You will, you know, start feeling lethargic. But do you think there are high mountains in Africa? No.
No.
Africa has grasslands. So you're never going to test that thing. So Africans can live very well with half of the gene mutated and half of the gene normal. And that will also help them to develop resistance against malaria, which is the most abundant cause of death in Africa. Even now, one in every three deaths in the world that happens due to malaria happens in Africa. You know? And according to the latest research, where other countries have tackled malaria very efficiently, like India and other countries, Africa is still suffering, and around 80 to 90% of the deaths are coming from malaria only. So for that population to have a mutation like this is actually beneficial. And this is the proof of life, proof of evolution happening in humans. In no other country, there are humans with half of their genes mutated to tackle something which is a natural calamity or a pathogen. You understand this? So we'll talk about it later again in our genetics chapter. But just know that this plasmodium, since we started with malaria, I'm just telling you some things. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
And what is the vector for malaria? It's a mosquito. For this plasmodium, now, what is the vector? Vector is something which helps in the transfer of something. It does not. So vector is that organism in which the pathogen does not affect. So plasmodium, when it is inside the mosquito's salivary gland, it does nothing to the mosquito. It is just staying there and waiting for the mosquito to bite someone and transfer it to human body, where it will start its full-fledged pathogenic activity. So what is the vector for plasmodium for malaria? You must have heard the name of the mosquito.
Dengue.
Dengue is another disease. It's not dengue, it's dengue. So the way we write it is D-E-N-G-U-E, right? Dengue, we call it, even in Hindi when we translate, we write on our posters and flyers as dengue. But the right pronunciation is dengue. So dengue is another disease just like malaria caused by another mosquito with a different name. So there are different mosquitoes which cause malaria and different mosquitoes which cause dengue. Do you know which mosquito causes? Do you know some names of mosquito? Anyone? Any names of, you have not heard of names of mosquito? Have you heard of this one name called Anopheles?
Yes, sir.
After I say, you have heard of everything, right? So Anopheles mosquito is the carrier for malaria. And for dengue, since because someone has asked, so what is the mosquito which causes dengue? For dengue, it's Aedes. Have you heard this name as well? Why is my pen not working? Hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, but the screen is not there. Oh, the screen is there. Zoom misbehaved for some time. Is the screen visible to you, all of you?
No, sir.
No? Okay, just 1 minute. Why is the screen not visible? I have to share it again, I think. Yes. So now is it visible to you?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So for dengue, the name is Aedes. Aedes causes dengue. So Aedes mosquito causes dengue and Anopheles mosquito causes malaria. Okay. So we will end the class on this note, and this concludes your Protista kingdom. So that is all you have to understand about Protista. Now do one thing, go back home, start with all these categories that we have studied under Protista and just look at their star marks. And you will appreciate what is different in which. You can even make a concept map for yourself. What I call as a concept map is a thing which student can make for its discussion. Write Protista in the center, then make diverging branches, 4 or 5 categories that we have studied. Write that branch, and in that branch, make another branches where you will write the star mark points. You understand?
Yes, sir.
This is called a concept map. So whenever you go for exams, especially objective exams, your entrances, you just look at the concept map. It will be in your mind that which feature is associated with which organism, and it will be helpful instantly. Because it's difficult to read every note before, as a part of revision, just before the exam, right? So make a concept map for yourself. And anyone has any doubts before I conclude the class for today?
No, sir.
Okay, so in the next class, we'll start with some videos which will help you align better towards Kingdom Protista and whatever we have studied before. And we will start with fungi, okay? And fungi is very interesting to study and also very deep, because fungi is asked a lot for two reasons. One, it is very important for us also, in a way that it helps, right, from baking. Yeast is also in fungi. And second, it helps in producing a lot of antibiotics. Penicillium notatum, which is a fungi, produced penicillin. So it becomes obviously important from medical point of view as well. Okay. Then we'll go to plants and animals. But as I told you, when I will start plants and animals, I will not just talk about classification. I will also take plant physiology and animal physiology together. It's fine. It's fine for everyone. Not going by the chapter and the textbook, but including learning everything that is connected.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So thank you. I hope you learned in today's class, and go back and revise, and see you in the next class.
Thank you, sir.
Bye. Good night.
Thank you, sir.
Good night.
Bye,
thank you, sir.
Sir, how will I get the previous notes?
Yes, please. So you stay and Ishita, right?
Yes.
So yes, Ishita. So what we'll do is, so because you have joined this batch, so you continue with this batch. And what we are planning for you is, we will give you backup classes. So you talk to Nishkarsh or whoever you are in contact with who gives you information about the classes. You talk to I think it's Nishkarsh, right? Who is it?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So you talk to Nishkarsh and tell him that you will be needing. So we will give you some extra classes to bring you to this point. So because last class was your first class where you started with me, the living system. We were discussing life processes, right? So that yes. whole chapter plus this half chapter, we have to cover for you separately. Okay. So we'll schedule classes for you. And by that time, we just continue with this batch. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Good night.